Hi, this is another video covering an engineering challenge that I encountered while working on the VR4300 CPU for the N64. Unlike the previous videos, this problem does not appear to be trivial at first glance, and it becomes even less so as you investigate it further. For this reason, this video will be split into two parts, the first part covering virtual memory and defining the problem constraints. The second part will cover actual implementations. Let's start off with a little motivation for what virtual memory and a TLB, or translation look-aside, buffer is. There are numerous videos and references on the internet that cover virtual memory in detail, so this will be a quick overview. To start off with, let's look at how memory is typically organized for a program written in C. Here we have a memory map which extends from address 0 to some high address. I'm not exactly sure where these specific addresses come from, but they help to keep the ordering straight. Let's consider a simple C program to help visualize which parts of the code are going where. Here we have some function foo, which allocates an array of integers, sets the value to 42, and then deallocates the array before returning. While this does not seem to do anything useful, we can imagine a case where we call another function after we initialize the array of integers, but before we deallocate them. When this code is compiled, it will be converted into a series of instructions for the processor to execute, which will look something like this. These instructions are referred to as the text of the program, and are stored in the text segment of the memory map. Each of the 32 registers used is denoted by a dollar sign followed by a number, with the exception of the global pointer, stack pointer, and frame pointer, which are represented by GP, SP, and FP, respectively. These mnemonics help us visualize what is going on better, however, each of them corresponds to one of the 32 general-purpose registers. In this example, we are using three types of memory. We have a global constant variable, A, which is stored just after the text section in a special part of the map global variables. We have two statically allocated variables, I and B, which store temporary variables and are located in the stack section of the memory map. And finally, we have the dynamically allocated array, B, which is stored in the data section of the memory map, which is more commonly referred to as the heap. Note that B was listed twice. This is because the array B is stored in the heap part of the memory map, while the address, which points to the array B, is stored on the stack. Any reference, such as writing to B, would require the address B to be loaded from the stack, and then the memory offset calculated, followed by a final store. You can see this in the assembly code on the right. Additionally, you can notice that the stack grows downward, or towards lower addresses, which is something you can see at the beginning of the program. The heap grows upwards or towards higher addresses. You may be asking what the point of showing this small program is. Well, the point is that this program follows the same convention of every C program, where it expects the text, data, and stack segments to be laid out in this specific way. Additionally, the entry point to the program, i.e. the first instruction to execute, is typically expected to be at address 0 in the text segment. Now, for a single program running on a processor, that's not a problem, and the program can be told exactly where main memory is for a specific system, which is how an operating system will run. We will, however, run into a problem if we want to run multiple programs together. Here we have two programs that we want to run. Let's say that we also have an operating system running, which will allow for multitasking, i.e. multiple programs to run at once. So in this case, we have three programs, Program 1, Program 2, and the operating system. You should hopefully see the problem right away. Program 1 is expecting its stack to start at the exact same place in memory as Program 2 is. Perhaps even more problematic is the fact that the text segments overlap, which is impossible since memory addresses can only be set to one value at a time, i.e. it would either be the instruction for Program 1 or for Program 2, not both. So how do we fix this? Well, we could disable multitasking, which is how computers from the 1980s dealt with this problem, or we could have the operating system shuffle them around in memory so they don't overlap. But if we shuffle them, then references in the code may no longer be valid, for example, jumping to a specific address in the text segment. And this is where virtual memory comes into play. Here, each program running has their addresses mapped to portions of physical memory at the operating system's discretion. So there are a few things to notice here. The segments are not necessarily mapped in a linear and contiguous way. Instead, they are mapped into blocks called pages. The segments don't need to be fully mapped into physical memory. It may be a little hard to see, but the highest address in the physical RAM in this diagram is smaller than the highest address for the programs. If the pages are not mapped to physical memory, then it is typically either unallocated or sitting somewhere on a slower medium, such as a hard disk drive. Both programs running think that their entire address space exists in RAM, and are none the wiser to the other programs running. This is very helpful for creating portable programs, which can run on different systems that are in different states of operation. For example, if neither program provides a service to the other needed to execute, such as a device driver, then the order in which the programs were executed does not matter. All modern computers use virtual memory, allowing for multiple programs to run at a single time, and have memory resources allocated to them as needed. So now that we have a motivation for what virtual memory is, and why we need it, we can look at how to implement it. We basically need a way to translate between the virtual address space on the left and the physical space on the right. There are two ways we can do this, and both have been done in the past. We can either have every memory access for a program create an exception, requiring the operating system to do the translation on the fly, or we could have the hardware do the translation for us. Obviously, having the OS do it will be incredibly inefficient, so modern processors use a hardware approach, which is done through a hardware unit called the TLB, or Translation Lookaside Buffer. Hopefully you now see why a TLB is important to have in a modern processor. By default, the N64 Software Development Kit did not provide any TLB functionality other than low-level commands for the game developers to use, though I'm not sure how many games actually took advantage of the TLB. It was, however, used extensively in the PlayStation 2. Since we are primarily interested in implementing an N64 and then an extension, a PlayStation 2, we want to specifically focus on the MIPS TLB. Here's an example showing the translation process for 64-bit virtual addresses. Note that in both the N64 and PS2, the physical address is only 32 bits. There are a few features of the MIPS TLB to take note of. Note that these features are true for each of the TLB entries. The entries provide variable page size functionality. In this diagram, the top virtual address uses 4 kilobyte pages, and the bottom virtual address uses 16 megabyte pages. Each entry in the TLB can have a different page size. Each entry contains an address space identifier, or ASID field, which can be used to specify different processes. For example, the ASID field can represent the process ID of a program running on the machine, where each process has its own unique set of virtual addresses. In the previous example, we could have two TLB entries, which have the same virtual page number denoted by VPN above, but program 1 could have an ASID of 1 and program 2 have an ASID of 2. Then depending on the program currently being executed, the TLB will map the appropriate location in memory. Each entry contains a permission field, where the entry can either belong to a kernel, supervisor, or user process. The difference here is what addresses are accessible by each permission and can be used to protect a rogue process from writing to or reading from kernel memory. This will also prevent user processes from reading or writing to memory mapped devices. Each entry maps to two pages via an even-odd mapping. This isn't shown in the diagram, but let's take the example of the 4 kilobyte page above. Here, the least significant bit of the VPN field, being bit 12, will determine if we are accessing the even page when bit 12 is 0, or the odd page when bit 12 is 1. This effectively allows us to get twice the mappings for free, keeping in mind that each even and odd pair can be anywhere in memory. And in place of the ASID field, there's also a global bit, which allows a page entry to be valid for all ASIDs. An example of where this would be useful would be loading a shared library into memory, such as the standard C library, which will only require one TLB entry instead of a TLB entry for each program running. Each of those features would be fairly trivial to implement on their own. However, the structure of the entire MIPS TLB leads to a few issues. The MIPS TLB is multi-entry, having 32 for the N64's VR4300 and 48 for the PS2's R5900. The TLB is also fully associative, which is one of the biggest problems. This means that we cannot use the virtual address information to help us determine where an entry is within the TLB, resulting in the requirement that all the entries must be simultaneously checked for a virtual address hit. So in the N64, this would be 32 simultaneous checks, and the PS2 would be 48. Because of this, we can't use a block RAM to store the TLB entries, like with the MIPS register file. The TLB uses indexed and random policies, meaning that a specific entry can be selected to be read or written to, or a random entry can be chosen as a target for a write. The random write target is useful in the case where we want to refill part of the TLB. The TLB allows for probe functionality, which allows the operating system to load a virtual address to search for, and the TLB will tell us the address exists in one of its entries. This is useful for remapping pages to different physical memory locations while keeping the same virtual addresses. And a feature that makes the fully associative TLB even more difficult to implement is the fact that the TLB can have a variable set of fixed entries. These are referred to as wired entries and are entries that will not be selected by the random policy. The number of these wired entries is determined by the operating system writing to a register to specify the desired number of them. These wired entries are useful for pages that we want to always be in the TLB. An example of this could be the page for the C library, which provides functionality that all the programs running on the system will need, potentially also including the operating system. So why would this make the TLB more difficult to implement? Well, if we didn't have the fixed entries, we could potentially fool the code running on the processor by thinking the TLB was fully associative, when instead we made it set associative, which is something that can be done with a block RAM. Unfortunately, having the fixed entries, and the fact that there can be a variable number of them, means that we need to implement something that is fully associative. So now that you know what the TLB needs to do, we can look at how fast it needs to do it. Let's go back to our favorite timing diagram from the VR4300. Both the instructions and the data will need to go through address translations, and their TLB timings are identical. Here you can see that the instruction fetch starts at the beginning of phase 2, ignoring the fact that the diagram does not quite line up correctly. And the TLB access needs to end 1.5 phases later. This is because while the address is being checked in the TLB, the address is also being used for a cache lookup, which can be done in parallel since the cache only relies on the offset portion of the virtual address. However, there is a physical address associated with the cache within the cache line tag, which needs to be checked with the physical address of the TLB. This check is done in the half phase block denoted by ITC, or instruction tag check. This block is a simple equal comparison, which will stall the pipeline if the tag does not equal the TLB physical address, i.e., it results in a cache miss. The instruction tag check should be quick, but notice that we need to read the TLB in 1.5 phases, or 3/4 of a cycle. This would be hard to do for a set associative TLB, and is even more difficult to do for a fully associative TLB. Also note that the VR4300 has a 32-entry joint TLB and a 2-entry instruction TLB. The instruction TLB is a subset of the joint TLB, which at least makes the instruction TLB reads a bit easier. Now what about the PS2's R5900? I couldn't find the timing diagram for the PS2's R5900, so this is inferred from the Sony documentation. It's unclear how the TLB works exactly, so this is a guess based on what I know from the VR4300. I also removed the RF stage in the timing diagram to help us see how the instructions and data translations are different. Since the R5900 is a dual-issue superscalar pipeline, it also has an instruction queuing stage, which is shown as the IQ stage. Additionally, the superscalar pipeline has a dedicated load store unit, which allows for the virtual address to be available in the second half of the execution stage. Similarly to the VR4300, the R5900 has a 48-entry joint TLB and a 2-entry instruction TLB, and it also has a 4-entry data TLB. According to the Sony documentation, the ITLB, DTLB, and TLB are all accessed at different stages in the execution, as shown in the diagram. I couldn't find any documentation on how exactly the JTLB and DTLB differ, or even how the ITLB and JTLB differ. However, it is likely that the DTLB and ITLB are similar to the VR4300's ITLB, where the entries represent a subset of the joint TLB, allowing for faster access. Now the problem is that the Sony documentation mentions both the I and D TLBs along with the joint TLB during each phase as shown, and I have no idea why they would mention the JTLB in the phase if the ITLB and DTLB are subsets of the JTLB. In theory, the JTLB in that case would be invisible to the pipeline, since the pipeline would stall during an ITLB or DTLB miss, and refill automatically from the JTLB, as in the VR4300. It's possible that the documentation mentions the JTLB during the pipeline stages to help reduce the latency required to refill the ITLB and the DTLB. In that case, the refill penalty would most likely be one cycle, as opposed to the VR4300's ITLB miss penalty of 3 cycles. Since it's not clear and easier to implement, let's use the same sort of ITLB and TLB interface from the VR4300, making the ITLB and DTLB of the R5900 incur a 3-cycle penalty, one for the probe, one for the read-write, and one for the translation. However, in that case, we still need to be able to translate an address and check the tag within a single cycle for the smaller I and DTLBs, and also perform a JTLB probe within a single cycle. It should be noted that by relaxing the 48-entry JTLB requirement to only require a probe to complete in a single cycle does help timing slightly. However, the R5900 clocked at 295 MHz when compared to the VR4300's 93.75 MHz, making these timing constraints problematic. So let's summarize what the structure of the N64's VR4300 TLB and the PS2's R5900 TLB. Here, each TLB is broken down into a joint data and instruction TLB, called the JTLB, and one or more micro TLBs for instruction and data. The micro TLBs are connected to the JTLB via a refill bus, and the JTLB is connected to the system coprocessor 0 registers. The connection of CP0 provide the manual lookup and refill functionality needed by the operating system. I have also shown where the instruction and data addresses are input into the TLB, and which unit provides the actual translation. We can see that the JTLB of the VR4300 needs to connect to both the refill bus and the data virtual address, requiring effectively two ports, while the R5900's JTLB only connects to the refill bus. For simplicity, I would opt to implement the R5900's TLB architecture into the VR4300 implementation, since it makes the overall implementation simpler. One port is easier to deal with than two, using different interface signals. We will, however, look at implementing both architectures in the next video, which on that note, the second part of this video will cover different implementations, FPGA logic synthesis results, and timing performance analysis of each implementation. Thanks for watching.